And she's working on a number of topics besides modular functions, but perhaps this is what she's more well known for. And even she got, like 2 years ago, a test paper award in ICML, actually with work about two modular functions. So without further ado,
thank you. So all the more pressure now to, on the lectures, despite the good weather. I hope you like it. So let's start. I'm going to talk about set functions for the next two lectures. And these segment functions will be submodular, so I'll tell you what this is. But before that, let's just see what is a set function at all. So what are we talking about? So a set function, essentially the setup is the following, that we have some set of items, a so-called ground set, and you're picking subsets of these items, and you have some function that scores what gives scores to these subsets of items. And this function could be a cost function, because it just bought lunch, for example. It could be a utility function, how much value do these items have for you together, or it could be a probability. And obviously, this function is not necessarily a linear function, but it adds up the value of the items. Utility could be very nonlinear, probabilities could be very nonlinear or not at all. So that's the setup here. We have some set function that we're talking about. So far this looks good, like it looks very relevant to real life, but what does this have to do with machine learning or other related things that we care about? Oh yeah, before I said like we go there, we'll assume that the set function is zero at the empty set, that's just really a shift, and then you get something that you can evaluate. This is more for complexity theoretic reasons. Okay, so where do set functions come up in machine learning and its applications? So let me just show you some examples to see sort of what this could model, what could be happening here. So one set of examples are discrete labeling problems. Really assigning discrete labels to something is like picking a set of items that plays a particular label. So for example, if I talk about computer vision, I may want to segment my image into foreground and background. So I'm picking essentially the pixels that are foreground pixels. Yes? The slides should be online on the website now. Yeah, I apologize that it didn't happen earlier. My hotel internet was very slow. So they should be online now, and they will also be on my website afterwards. Okay, so we have the segmentation problem. We're essentially picking a set of pixels that take the same label. And there's, of course, constraints here. For example, pixels that are close to each other most likely have the same label, so we have some kind of spatial coherence, and also the labels have to somehow agree with what we actually see. Similarly, there's this problem of co-segmentation, where I get a bunch of images and I don't know anything, and I'm trying to figure out what is the object that's common in these images. So I'm picking sort of a set of locations, one in each image, and I'm trying that are somehow similar. So that would also be a subset selection problem. Then there's many other problems where this comes up. So for example, you have a large set of data, a large set of documents, and you're trying to extract somehow a summary from these. A small set that represents their content as well as possible. So in this case, you want the subset that you extract to somehow be not redundant, to somehow represent the content of this thing, and so on. So your set function probably measures something like a non-redundancy or diversity and some kind of relevance score. And this also is very useful if, for example, you apply to search queries, if you do recommendation, and so on. So this occurs in a lot of places. And a very related setting is essentially the extraction of informative subsets. Do you have another question?
Yeah, I'm just wondering, all the examples sound more like you're interested in the inverse function. So you have some core and then you're looking for a set that's fulfilling this problem. These things sound like
yes, that's essentially. So what you could model it as some kind of like inverse problem, is that what you mean?
Yeah, so
you have some set and you have a function that gives values to these sets, and the question is, what is your observations? Maybe, can you like explain a little bit more?
Yeah, to go back to your last example.
Alright.
So here I have the impression you're more looking for the set that's fulfilling some property and giving you that's. So the set is the output of your function.
Yeah, so there's essentially these functions come up when we want to, well, essentially have some probabilities or scores on sets. And I'm just giving you some examples and trying to tell you sort of what these functions would measure, and we are interested in that case in the optimum of that function, for example. So this is just the question is then how do you actually model these problems and how do you find the optimal, for example. So that's in the end like a question that's relevant. So other problems where set functions or subsets occurs in say active learning or trying to place sensors in different parts of the room or so, where you want to find the subset of variables or say the set of experiments to run that give you the most information, as much information as possible about the thing that you want to learn about. And there's another set of, well, problems where subsets occur, and this is in high-dimensional statistics and inference with very high-dimensional variables, let's say images, large time series, or so, where we want to, one simple example is denoising, where, for example, you observe a noisy image, you know this image somehow has some underlying image plus noise, you want to find out what was the image. So you know you can actually represent a true image as a sparse combination of some basis vectors, for example. So in the end, you know, if you knew like which basis vectors these are, then you're done, then you can reconstruct it. So in the end, you're just trying to find out of a very long vector of possible coordinates what are actually the real coordinates that represent your image. So it's a subset selection problem of basis that represent your image. Similarly, in other high-dimensional problems, what are essentially the important coordinates in this? So the subset here is just the set of coordinates that we care about, and the function here is possibly a regularizer that's a penalty on the support. That's what the set function is. And of course, something that tells you about your how it relates to your observation. Okay, so all of these are some kind of problems where subsets occur, where some functions occur that assign scores to these subsets. So all of these problems, as different as they may seem, they can be formalized as optimizing a set function. So that's great, so we have sort of one unifying framework to view these, but it's also not so great because in general, just optimizing like any kind of set, if you pick your favorite NP-hard problem, most likely you can phrase it as the problem of optimizing some kind of set function. So it's good, we can view it this way, it doesn't help us yet for flexibility. So we need something else, we need some kind of mathematical structure that we can exploit. And this is where the submodularity property comes in. If you know your set function actually has this property, then there's a lot of things you can do much better with theoretical guarantees and computationally actually factorable. So that's why we care about them. And it turns out all of these problems can be modeled in relation to submodular functions. That's why I told them. Okay, so with this little introduction, you see, okay, maybe we actually care about set functions, even if we thought we may not. Here's the roadmap for the next two lectures. So we start with like actually a definition of submodularity, and I'll tell you a little bit what it is, where does it come out, how do I prove that something is submodular, sort of that you get a feel for what is actually a submodular function. And then we'll go into optimization, so there's actually a lot of different topics around submodular functions. I'll pick two of them, because that's sort of coherent, and I'll just sort of outline the other ones to you in the very end. So this is optimization, so we'll try to maximize the submodular utility function, or minimize a submodular function. So minimization will be the second lecture. These two are very, very different. The first one is mostly related to maximizing diversity, repulsion, and it's sort of related to concave aspect of submodular functions, and the other one is related to why we call a submodular function a discrete analog of convexity. So there's very different, interesting stories. So stay tuned for both of them. So, but before, now let's start with just what is actually a submodular function and why is it so interesting. Oh yeah, and if you want to learn more, of course this is just two lectures, I also have a literature list, there's the link, it's on the slides, if you download the slides, you have the link as well, that has many more pointers to papers and other tutorials and reading material if you want to learn more. Okay, so what is a submodular set function? What defines a submodular function? For that, let's start with an example, let's start with a sensing example. So simple example, say we have a room, we want to monitor that room and find out what's the temperature in all of these locations to detect a fire outbreak, if there is one, as quickly as possible. So the aim is really to sort of gather as much information as possible, but of course we are resource constrained, these sensors cost something, so we don't want to place too many. And the question is, where should we place these sensors to get as much information about the temperature this hidden variable as much information as possible. So let's see how we could model this. So let's say we actually have a function that models how much information we get from these sensors. This function, what will be important about this function is what's called the marginal gain. So essentially it's just, say we have placed sensors at a location A, how much do I gain from adding another sensor at location S? And this is called the marginal gain. Now this particular function, if you think about it, has the following property, and that's actually defining for submodularity. Let's say I have placed two sensors, and I look how much do I gain from adding another one, and then I go a little bit further, and I say I have added a few more sensors in the meanwhile, and I look at the marginal gains again. So in the first case, I have not placed many. Actually, adding this extra one helps me a lot. It sort of covers that entire area that you haven't seen before. On the other hand, if I put it to the very full setting, in the larger set B, where B is a superset of A, then I actually don't gain much anymore. I already know everything. But that's kind of the defining property here. So we can also formalize that. So what this formally means is that if I add my new sensor to the smaller set, I always gain more than adding it to the larger set. Or the more I have, the less I learn, the less I get from adding another point, and in this case, sensors. So the inequality that you see down here, this is really the defining inequality, and this is the only inequality that you should remember throughout this part. So this is the inequality that defines submodularity, this diminishing marginal returns or diminishing gains. And obviously, intuitively, some kind of information function will have this property, and possibly others as well. So this is diminishing gains. Now, submodular functions can also be cost functions. So here's an example of a submodular cost function, and the inequality is the same. So here what we look at is, how much does my price increase if I add another element? So as a simple example, say you bought some lunch item and you add a drink to it, you probably have to pay the additional euro or two for the drink. Now, if it's a free refill, then once you have bought one drink, basically all the other drinks of that same kind come for free. So the marginal cost of these other drinks is zero. Once I have paid one, the others come for free. So this is a phenomenon of economies of scale that is also modeled by submodular functions. So in terms of cost functions, what this means, if I buy lots of similar or coherent, the marginal costs decrease for all the items. Okay, so submodularity is defined as there, diminishing marginal gains, diminishing marginal costs. If you see submodular functions, you may also see another definition, and this is the following. It's equivalent to this one, and it's defined in terms of unions and intersections. So in the previous case, we had sort of A was a subset of B, and then we look how much do we gain from adding one element to A. Now we look at two arbitrary sets, S and T, and we look at the function evaluated at their intersection and union. So what happens here is that f of s plus f of t is bigger than f evaluated at the union and f evaluated at the intersection. The upper one is often more intuitive than the lower one, but both of them are very useful, and if you want to prove something in submodular, one or the other may be more useful. And you can show their equivalence by essentially mapping the sets correctly, and then you can show it effectively. Yes?
So in the first definition, we don't ask E to be in or outside of A or B, it's whatever.
Oh, yeah, E should be outside of B.
Oh, it has to be outside?
It should be outside of B, yes. If it's inside A, then basically there's, like, it's there's a zero in both sides. And so, yeah, like, strictly, it has to be outside of B, and not in either of the sets. Any other questions so far? Yes? Proving that one of them holds is fine. They are equivalent, so the other one will hold. You don't need, yeah, so you only have to prove this. Say you prove the first one, you have to prove it for all sets A and B and all elements E. So all E outside of B. If you can show this, then the second one also holds. Okay, so just sort of for the big picture, I cannot talk about submodularity without at least mentioning a few of the names of the people who actually started looking at submodularity in the very beginning. So some of these are Gustav Choquet, who wrote a paper on the theory of capacities in 1955. And thereafter, Shapley and Jack Edmonds had about the same time published papers about the polytopes that we look at in the second lecture, and generalizing from matroids to submodular functions. Matroids are some concept in combinatorics, kind of a combinatorial version of independence. And Shapley was working in game theory, actually, so that related that to game theory. Moreover, like submodular functions actually occur in lots of different places. So we look at machine learning today, but they actually occur in graph theory, in game theory, in information theory, many other places. You'll see sort of marginal little pieces of some of these areas today. So there's actually a much, much bigger theory and a much, much bigger thing behind it than what I'm going to show you today. All right, and LOAS is the guy behind the LOAS extension that we will also see. So let's look at some examples of submodular functions. I showed you one, let's see a few more. So maybe the simplest example is the following, that all of my items have a weight, say a cost, and the cost of a set of items is just the sum of their weights, or the sum of their costs. So typical example when you go to the supermarket. So what happens to my inequality? So what I need to show is this inequality, so I know that if I add my item E to my set A, well, my price will be cost by the weight of E. And what happens if I add it to B? Well, exactly the same, right? So in both cases, actually, the marginal gain is the weight of that single element. So I have equality for all elements, hence proof. So this has to be an inequality smaller or equal than, so a larger equal than, that's actually fine. So this is also called a modular function. It's just a linear function, essentially, that is always submodular. And in fact, fn minus f is submodular. So if I have any submodular function, I add or subtract one such function from it, it doesn't matter. This thing is both fn minus f is submodular, generally it's not the case. So this is the simplest function. Let's maybe see some other examples that are more interesting. So let's go back to our sensing example. Let's see how we could actually formally model this thing. And the easiest way to model this maybe is by modeling it as a coverage problem. So essentially, every sensor has its own little circle, that's the area that it covers. And we want to cover as much area as possible with as few sensors as possible. So the function here is just the area that's jointly covered by the sensors that have this. We're just placing disks in the plane, essentially. And the proof by picture is the more sensors, so the more area I've already covered, the less I gain from adding that particular sensor in this particular place. So the green area is the marginal gain. So the marginal gain will never increase, it will always decrease, and eventually be zero. But this is, of course, a very simplistic model for sensing. It's just like this coverage thing. Maybe we can do something slightly more sophisticated. So here is a graphical model thing. So we have our hidden variables, y, these are the temperatures in the room, and the actual observations that we have are the variables x. So x is just like y plus some noise. And we have some noise probability over this. So now what we could actually look at is something, for example, the mutual information between these two. So essentially the utility of observing variables in place A is just like the reduction in entropy that I get in, or the reduction in uncertainty about my hidden variables Y. And this is the mutual information between Y and the variables XA. So XA means all the variables indexed by stuff in the set A. So this is the mutual information. So let's see what happens to this function. And we'll have to make one assumption. So the mutual information can also be rewritten in this form. It's just the entropy of the variables in A minus the conditional entropy. And if we make one assumption, and that is that the variables in Y, the X variables are conditionally independent given the Ys, then this is actually turns out to be a submodular function. So how do I see this? Let me get sort of, if you're high level, proof how you see this. So the second term, in fact, if X is conditionally independent on Y, what this really means is that the entropy of X given Y is a sum of entropies. Sum of entropies, one for each variable. So this is actually a linear function, it's the same as my sum of weights function. So this is fine, this is submodular, whatever I do with it. So what really remains is the first term. So now we have, let's assume these are discrete random variables, we have the entropy of a set of discrete random variables. So now f of a is the joint entropy. So what happens? So this is just a formula for it. Let's look at the marginal gains again. So this is what we have to show. So let's look at the marginal gains. So what happens if we add one more element, one more variable to our set? Well, the entropy that we actually get to of the variable E given A, essentially how uncertain am I about E given I know all the variables in A. And now there's one principle here, and that is that information never hurts. So if I condition on more and more variables, my entropy actually can never increase. So the more I know, I'm not going to get more uncertain about my variable E. So given that this happens, actually the conditional entropy condition on B is actually smaller than on A, and hence we get this inequality. So hence what this shows is that this free entropy is actually a sub-Hausdorff function. And this also shows that this mutual information is a sub-Hausdorff function. So that's our connection to information theory, one of them. There's another interesting thing that comes up here. So we saw that, well, this mutual information and entropy are submodular functions, but there's one more phenomenon, and this is, you probably know this, is if I have the joint entropy of a sum of independent variables, the entropy is actually the sum of the variable-wise entropies. And the sum is sort of like things that I have to sum. So in some sense, submodularity means, if it's sort of strict submodularity, means that they are somehow statistically dependent. And if not, it's a modular function, it's the sum. So somehow in my submodular function, I can see the dependence of the variables happening. And this kind of submodularity and dependence actually also occurs in other places. So here's another submodular function that I could define. Let's say I have a set of vectors, and I pick a subset of these vectors, and I put them together in a matrix, and I measure the rank of this matrix. It's essentially, if they're all linearly independent, the rank is going to be the number of the vectors, and otherwise it's going to be smaller. So this also turns out to be a submodular function with exactly the same phenomenon that if the vectors are linearly independent, then the function value is the sum of values and otherwise it's smaller. And in fact, a lot of the submodular functions are actually can be viewed as some kind of generalization of this independence concept. If it's a sum, it's independent, and otherwise it's strictly submodular, there's some dependence between the items. All right, let's look at some other examples. Here's another example. This is an example with networks. So let's say we put some information in the network, that we have a social network, for example, and we see how it spreads in the network. So you sort of inform one node, and it informs its neighbors with some random process, and so on and so forth, the process spreads. And what our function measures here is like, what's the spread of the, how many nodes are informed after, say, t time steps, given that we inform nodes, the seed nodes in S. So S is the set of seed nodes, how much of my information spreads. And you see, it kind of looks like a coverage function. And in fact, it is kind of like a coverage function. It's essentially a randomized version of a coverage function. So you can show, actually, again, that the more nodes you are informing, the less you gain from informing yet another one, so adding one. So this also turns out to be a submodular function. So sort of finding the set of seed nodes that maximizes the spread in the network is a submodular maximization problem. Okay, so here's another example that you probably are familiar with. That's an example of finding the minimum part in the graph. So let's say we have a graph, we pick a set of nodes, and the function value, the cost function, is the sum of the edge weights that we have in the graph. So that, I claim, is also a submodular function. Let's see how we could actually show this. And to show this, let's look at the simplest possible graph. It's just one edge in the network. So what happens here? The only, and here we'll actually prove the other inequality. Remember the one with f of s plus f of t has to be bigger than f of s union t plus f of s intersection t. And in this case, the only non-trivial case is that s is one node and t is the other node, because otherwise they're already both the union intersection. So what happens? So this is what we have to show, that this holds. So let's look at it. So we pick one node, and the function value is we cut the edge, so it's the weight of the edge. We pick the other node, the function value is also the weight of the edge. If we pick both of them, there's no more edge to cut. It's zero. If we pick nothing, there's no edge to cut, so it's also zero. Hence, 2 times the weight is bigger than 0. So that probably holds if the weight is non-negative. So if my edge weights are non-negative, I have a submodular function. So there's one step more involved, going from one edge to the full graph, and the entire step that's involved is that if I have a sum of submodular functions, it remains submodular. So you can just see it by summing up inequalities on both sides. A graph cut is nothing else than a sum of edge-based cuts. So you just sum up the functions for all edges, you get the cut of the full graph. So graph cut is a submodular function. And this is one example where we actually use the other inequality. So my last two examples are related to probability distributions defined by submodular functions. So far I had sort of some kind of scoring or cost function. Let's look at two other examples. And the first one is, let's just realize, I'm sure that this looks like trivial, but let's just sort of realize this, that every set function is actually a function on binary vectors. So every set that I have, a subset of my vectors, of my items, I could write it as an indicator vector. So this is going to be important throughout the lecture that we can do this. So essentially, I have one coordinate for every item in my set, in my ground set, and I'm picking those items, so I just make a one wherever I'm picking the items. So my set function is nothing else than a function on binary indicator vectors. So where do I deal with binary vectors? So here's a very classical example from computer vision. It's, say, you want to label images. We have Markov random fields in that. So we want to label this image, what we observe are the pixels. We want to see what's foreground and what's background. So what we have in this case is a conditional distribution of the labels given the pixel value. So I observe these pixel values, I want some conditional distribution, and I model this as a Gibbs model. So I have some kind of energy function here, this E function, which is a function of my observation in the labels. And now this is minus E, so the smaller the energy, the larger is the probability. So finding the maximum most likely labeling is the same as minimizing this energy function. Alright, so what is this energy function typically? So let's see what we actually want to model here. So the first level, this energy function should be somehow related to my pixels. So typically it has some kind of log likelihood term in there that, given that, like, say my label is 1, what would be the most likely output, or how likely is this output that I see given the label is 1 or 0. So I have some color models or some appearance models given my... Oh, yeah, my device is going by itself. Let me just check one thing. Okay, now we can continue. Alright, so energy mod. So what we have one term that's essentially, sorry about this PowerPoint, sometimes does these nasty things. So we have one term that's basically per pixel, and it says, like, given that I observe this pixel, how likely is it this is, given that I have this label, how likely is it that this is the pixel. So this is sort of local terms, pixel by pixel. That's just the sum of these likelihood terms. So if I were to be doing this, is like sort of classification pixel by pixel. And if I do the segmentation this way, you see this is what comes out. It kind of is correct, but it's quite noisy. So what typically is the assumption? Well, you know there's more to an object than just appearance. For example, you know that it's spatially coherent. So we can add some terms that say, well, if two pixels are next to each other, they should probably have the same label, or be more likely to have the same label. So if we add these terms, these are now PRS terms for two pixel labels that are in the same neighborhood, two pixels that are next to each other. If we add those, the most likely labeling looks much better. So this is the math solution. So this is the typical reasoning. So what's now up with this energy function? If we look at this energy function very closely, it models spatial coherence. So what we really want from this energy function, especially from the second part, so the first part is like linear function. Again, it's modular, it's always submodular. The second part models spatial coherence. That means if the two pixels in there take different labels, that's what I don't want. So if they take different labels, that should be larger, higher energy, more penalty than if they take the same labels. So I get this kind of inequality, and in fact, this inequality is exactly the same as submodularity. If I say that, well, I have two items, again, I have this edgewise cut, like the edgewise cut, two items, two labels. If they are different, 1, 0, I'm picking the first one, if it's 0, 1, I'm picking the second one. So that's just like the indicators of two items. And I see this is actually the same as submodularity. So the energy functions that are typically used here that model spatial and temporal coherence are typically also submodular functions. So what is perhaps the opposite? I do not always want to select items that are sort of close to each other. So the opposite of this would be a diversity prior, say. And this comes up, for example, it has been used in localizing people in images. You know that people are like that, and people that are most likely not going to stand all in the same location. So I want it somehow to be spread out in space. So what you have here is like some kind of likelihood term, and then some prior that says, well, the set of people is somehow spread out in space. The question is, how would you model this? You could model this with graphical models. It kind of works, but it's also a bit not so easy to easily tractable. So here's another model that actually works particularly well if you want to model errors. So all the model requires is that you have a similarity function between your items. That gives you a positive definite similarity kernel. Or matrix, which is which could be a kernel matrix. So we have this matrix, if I have an item, it's an N by N similarity matrix. Now the probability of, say, the items in S occurring together, so the probability of the set S is the following. That I take my similarity matrix, and I take the submatrix index by S. And the probability is proportional to the determinant of that submatrix. And that's it. So of course, I have to normalize it. It turns out it's actually fine. This thing, all it needs is that similarity matrix. So why is it a good idea? Why should this model anything like diversity? Why should somehow sets that are different, have items that are different from each other, be somehow more likely than sets that are items that are close? Like this looks pretty abstract. I could claim anything to you. Like I'm not going to do determinants in my head. So let me just show you how we model something that's diverse. The determinant is actually the same as the volume. So let's say your similarity matrix is actually measure is actually a dot product. Most often you can actually write it as some kind of dot product. So you have vectors xi, I equals 1 to n. And now the determinant is actually proportional to the volume spanned by these vectors. And by volume, I mean, say, I have these two vectors, I complete that to a parallelogram. And that's the volume spanned by these two vectors. And 3, it would be a cube, and so on. So if they are very close to each other, that means they are almost linearly dependent, or they are actually the same, then this volume becomes smaller and smaller. So the more orthogonal they are, the larger is the volume that they actually span. Hence, this the probability actually prefers sets of vectors that are very orthogonal to each other. If they are linearly dependent, actually the determinant is zero, it's going to have zero probability. So this is how you can see this actually models diversity, and oh, it turns out this function actually is a submodular function. It's just the opposite of this energy function. So just to show that this also actually works, here's a sample where I just take as a similarity measure a Gaussian kernel over like difference of spatial location. And on the right hand side you see a uniform sample, on the left hand side you see a sample from the DPT. And the DPT sample is somehow more spread out than the uniform sample. Similarly, for the head of it, here's another like instance that can be modeled by this. Let's say you take a sequence of random numbers. And now in my sequence I mark every time my sequence goes down. So the number is smaller than the preceding number. So I get a set of locations that's actually distributed as a DPT with a very special similarity matrix, of course. So I could look at this and I could compare it again to a set of random locations that I choose uniformly at random. And you see they're, like, well, in this case, slightly more spread out than the uniform ones. So that's, again, a special case of a probability distribution induced by a submodular function. Often they have this combinatorial interesting flavor. So we see there's actually a lot of different ways submodular functions come up in different examples. So we saw linear functions, graph-graph functions, coverage functions, or diffusion in networks, very closely related to coverage. We have entropy and rank function and some kinds of things that model independence. And then we have distributions that are defined by submodular functions, which either model something like repulsion and diversity, or they model something like coherence. Okay, so we know a lot of examples. Let's see how we could construct submodular functions from other submodular functions. So, for example, here's a few things That's like how we can construct submodular functions from ones that we already have. Useful also for proving that something is submodular. So one example is, well, say we have a submodular function f, we could only restrict it to a small subset, so the set W would only measure the red area. Or we could do something, well, which I could call conditioning, is that we always include W with whatever we do. So we forcefully union with W and measure everything union W. That actually is pretty much the same as measuring marginal gain with respect to W. And then we could do something like a reflection where instead of measuring on S, we actually measure the complement of S. And it turns out that also remains a submodular function. So if F is submodular, this complement thing is also submodular. Okay, so these are just some examples of how we closeness properties. There's a few more, we've seen the sum, and so on. So now we see that kind of there's a lot of these submodular functions come up. Why are they interesting? But if you think about sort of the continuous world, interesting functions in many cases are convex functions. And now if you look at submodular functions, we could pose the question is that discrete set function, of course it's not really a convex or concave, but is it somehow rather like a convex function or a concave function? And actually people have worked on this for a long time and there's debates about this. Let me show you some arguments pro and con. So let's start with convexity. So here's the name Lolas again. There was actually a paper on submodular functions and convexity. And it starts with the following. Why do we care about convex functions? Well, first of all, they're pretty generic. There's lots of things we can model with convex functions. Not everything, but lots of things. So they occur in many different problems. And often they are the only non-trivial property that all of these things share. That's sort of the smallest common subset in some sense. The largest common subset. Then convexity is preserved under many different operations, so you can take sums, there's many other things you can do with convex functions and it remains convex. Then convex functions still, they're somehow not only interesting in that they have lots of different applications, they also have a nice rich theory behind it. Then somehow, efficiently, essentially, there's ways to do this, there's a lot of rich theory behind convexity. There's lots of books on convexity, tons of literature on convexity. So somehow there's also they are mathematically interesting as well. And then he concludes with, it is less apparent, but we claim and hope to prove to a certain extent that a similar role is played in discrete optimization by submodular set functions. He claims share the above four properties. So I already showed you, they come up in many different places, many more than I actually showed. Now we want to show you a little bit about the theory of submodular functions, minimization will do in the second lecture. So there are some reasons sort of you could parallel them with convex functions, but there's actually also more concrete reasons. And that is that they are actually closely related to convex functions. There's a duality theory, there's actually a convex function you can construct from submodular functions. So that's what is reliable. So this is all nice and good, but actually, if you look at the definition of submodularity, that's actually more like concavity. If you think about diminishing returns, what this really means, it's like the derivative shrinks. And functions where the derivative shrinks, these are really concave functions, not convex functions. So in some sense, this also, the definition itself is also like already a discrete concavity, which is very weird in some sense, or it's also very interesting because you could also use both properties. And the connection is actually deeper than just that. You could construct a set function as follows, that you take your set, and you take its cardinality, and you apply any function to this cardinality. That gives you a set function. Now this set function is submodular if and only if this function g that you apply is actually a concave function. So you can show that. Only submodular if and only if g is concave. So there's actually more direct connections to concavity than just this definition. So let's see if this actually goes a bit further, like these two properties. There's, for example, the following. If I take two convex functions, I can use and it remains a convex function. So this always works. What about submodular functions? So what do you think? How many people think if I take the max of two submodular functions, it's going to be submodular? Yes? What about the minimum? Okay, let's see. The rest, still trying to make up the mind. So take the maximum of two submodular functions. Let's take the submodel functions defined by concave functions that I showed you, that I argued these are like f of a is like g of cardinality of a. In this case, I take the max. The max actually is no longer a concave function. It's some other function with multiple modes. It's not concave. And I said, well, this function is still a function of the cardinality. If this thing doesn't look like a concave function, the function is not submodular. So indeed, you were right, it doesn't hold. Well, we can look at the minimum. So this looks like more like concave function. Maximum of the concave function is not concave. Minimum of two concave functions is actually a concave function. So let's see this for a submodular function. What we have to show is this. So here's an example. Here are two submodular functions on two elements. These are the two functions. So one is like 1 on A, the other one is 1 on B, and they are both 1 on both. So now if we take the minimum of the two, we get a function that is 0 everywhere except for the union of A and B, which is just, A comma B. And then if we just plug these values into our inequality, we see that it actually doesn't hold. So minimum and maximum is sort of one of the few things that submodular functions are not closed on. So minimum or maximum of submodular functions may not be submodular. I guess may get lucky, it may be submodular, but in general it's not. So that doesn't hold in general. So it's not exactly like convex and concave, although. Anyways, this is not so obvious. Yeah?
Could you please go back three sides, I think, to your example with the cardinality? Do you have any example, I mean, a simple example you can show us that a function cannot be written as g of cardinal of A? Just a little bit before.
A subset function?
Yes.
You think that all of them can be written as this? Yeah, so.
But there.
This
there
one?
Easy way to show us that.
That not all of them can be written as this?
I can't find one.
Yeah, so I know an example which is not so trivial. Indeed, many of the functions that I showed you are. So here's one like not so easy argument, and there may be an easier function. So I showed you that graph cut function, right? So essentially you can show that all the functions that can be written in this form can be written as a graph cut function and vice versa. But there's a proof that not all submodular functions can be written as a graph cut function, even if you add the actual proof and the function is not so intuitive. It's like a function on four items and you have to show all the values. So this is like, it's not a very good example, but this is one example that proves it. Yeah, very good question though. Okay. All right, so now let's actually go on and say we know actually we have our submodular function. Let's see what we can do. But we want to do some computation. We have some model that has some submodularity in it. Can we minimize or maximize the function? Now we're going to do it. Let's start with maximization. And essentially, we saw that submodular functions have both convex and concave properties, and we're going to use these to our advantage where they are useful. So in general, convex functions are good for minimization. Maximization of a convex function is not all that great. The maximum could be anywhere at the boundary. We don't know, so it's hard. Similarly, for minimization of concave functions is hard, but maximization of concave functions is nice. So for maximization, you'll use concavity. And as a reminder, the problem we're going to solve, submodular maximization. Okay. Where do we care about submodular maximization? Well, one example is when we have functions that say measure information, you want to maximize the information that we have. When we do summarization, we want to maximize the content that we represent and maximize the minimize the redundancy or maximize the non-redundancy in some sense. When we do influence in graphs, often we want to actually maximize our influence. We want to spread information as quickly as possible, however we want to do it. Here's the summarization example. I just wanted to show you a few sort of like examples how you could actually model this. Information and spread we already had. So mostly what these summarization models do is they have some kind of sense of coverage and some kinds of diversity of the set of items that you take. So here are some simple ways you could actually model this. The first one is the following. You have your set of items And your function says that every item should be well represented. So the way you can model this is by saying that for every item that you have, you pick sort of the closest neighbor that you have actually selected, the closest red neighbor in this, and then you measure the similarity to that neighbor. And if you're very close, you're very well, like the similarity is high, you're very well represented. If the similarity is low, you're very badly represented. You want to maximize that score. Obviously, if you pick two red points very close to each other, they're all going to pick one or the other, so picking only one of them would be good enough. So you get this redundancy. You don't actually gain much from adding two points in the same location. You'd rather spread them out. So what you get from this is some kind of maximum coverage of your data set. Here's some way how we could model diversity. If we actually actively want them to sort of be different from each other, here's one thing we could do. We could cluster the data set and say we want to pick as few as possible in every cluster. So this is, maybe we know these groups or topics or whatever, this is one way to model this. How would we enforce that we only want one in each? And we want to maximize this, we want this to be a submodel function. So one simple way is to say, well, for every cluster that I pick a point in, I get one score, and I get zero other, like for the second one, I don't get anything. Or maybe for the second one, I get like half more, or I get a little bit more, and for the third one, a third more, or something like that. So I could also do a square root here. So the more I pick from every cluster, the less I get from every additional thing that I pick in this cluster. And then I just sum over the cluster. So it's best, since I get the most, the best score for the first point, I try to be the first point in every cluster. This also turns out to be a submodel function. It has this diminishing returns property. Okay, so here's another function that models diversity. And this is the following, that I again look actually at the different points, but now at similarities, but now I look at the similarity of points that I pick. And I penalize the similarities. So my score is the negative of all the pair of similarities that I have. That also turns out to be a submodel function. But there's a crucial difference between the left and the right function. So anyone see a difference, like sort of general difference between these functions? Other than, of course, they are like very different functions, but... Yes, and one is actually even more so, one is positive, one is negative, very good. One is increasing and one is decreasing. So the left hand one, even though I add points, I never decrease the function. I'll just level off at some point and that's it. The right-hand side, it actually is going down and down and down. It actually gets steeper and steeper and steeper the more points I add. So that's going to be a difference with respect to optimization. Then there's lots of more problems where maximization comes up, and there are like many of these are actually in my literature list if you want to read the paper. So you can use it for learning networks, for doing object detection, for doing recommender systems, and doing co-segmentation and so on. So one more point about this monotonicity. So I said somehow increasing and decreasing is somehow very different. So increasing and decreasing is called monotone, and the set function is monotone or monotone increasing if the following holds that. If my set grows, the function value never decreases, it only increases. So for example, a coverage function has this property. The more sensors I add or the more coverage I get, but it's never going to get negative, it's never going to decrease again, it's just going to stall at some point. Whereas if I look at my graph cut function, actually I take a small set, I get a cut of 3 here, and I increase that set, I get a cut of 5, and I take more and more nodes, and eventually I'm actually going to decrease my function value again, because I've picked the entire graph. So the right-hand side one is decreasing at some point, and the left-hand side is never decreasing. That's an important difference. So since they use different algorithms, let's start with the left-hand side. Let's start with increasing submodular functions. Let's try to maximize this function. So here's our problem. So in fact, I'm done now. This problem is easy. This problem is constant time solvable. Take the full set. It's increasing. I want to maximize it. Take as much as possible. It's going to be the optimal solution for sure, an optimal solution. So most likely that's not what we want. So most likely we have something else in mind than that, so we need to add some constraints. So most often what we have is some kind of budget constraint. So for example, we say we want to pick n of k. Now different. Now full set is not even feasible anymore. Now we have like n choose k possible sets to choose from. This is not as easy. And in fact, it turns out this is actually hard. So max cover is one of the examples of this, so it shows this is actually hard. But nevertheless, there's not only bad news. In fact, there's pretty simple algorithms that give pretty good solutions, and these all fall into the family of. So let's look a little bit at greedy algorithms. So in the simplest case with k, here's the algorithm that solves this sort of theoretically best possible polynomial time algorithm, turns out to be luckily a very easy one. So here's the algorithm that I start with the empty set and I pick the item that gives me the best score. And then I pick the item that gives me the best additional score. So I look at all possible items that give me the best marginal gain over this item and I add that to my set and so on until I see k, and that's it. So that's arguably very simple. How good is that? So that's all, maybe even the first thing one would try, like try some crazy thing, it may work. So how good is this? Let me show this to you by an example and then I'll show you actually the theorem. So here is an example of this thing, how this thing actually works. So this is an animation by a colleague. This is again a problem from computer vision that we try to do detection of pedestrians. So what we have on the, we have some bipartite graph. On the left hand side we have different patches in this picture that can be explained by different hypotheses. Hypothesis means there's a person in this location. So they have different, can be explained to different extents by different hypotheses, hence we have these edges and they have weights. Now if we pick a few hypotheses, the score that we get is the following, that every patch on the left-hand side picks sort of the best possible hypothesis that we have picked on the right-hand side. So in fact we have seen this function before, it's the same as this coverage thing for summarization. And we try to pick now the best hypothesis. What we see on the right-hand side, this is sort of the heat map of how, like the scores of every possible location. This is like we get this diffuse thing. Now we want to pick a few of these points. So how does this work? So here's, now we run the greedy algorithm on this. We pick a few, like up to k hypotheses. So here's, we pick the brightest one, that's the best marginal gain, and then we take it and then look at the marginal gains given this. So this point disappears because everything around there is explained and everything else that we pick in this location is going to not help us. So we pick the next point, marginal gain with respect to the next point, this basically disappears and so on and so forth. So this is what typically happens with the greedy algorithm. So this is what it, and this is what it selects for the pedestrian, it actually works quite well. So that's sort of like visually it seems to work, and in fact you can also numerically show that often it works quite well. Oh yeah, going on. So here's a plot that shows that's for the sensor placement problem. Numerically often it's pretty close to optimal. So in fact it's often like better than the theorem I'm going to show you, and I can also explain you why, but this is sort of like in general it works actually pretty well in practice, also by numerical. So what does the theory say? So the theory says the following, that this is the guarantee that I get if S star is the optimal solution, I get at least a 1 minus 1 over a fraction of the optimal solution, which is around 63%. So it's not bad. So in the worst case, I'm at least that close. I'm up and I'm better. And I'm better, you can actually quantify this by other properties of your function. But this is what I would get for sure with a greedy algorithm. And this is in fact the best you can expect from any polynomial time. All right, so this was pretty easy, but maybe my constraints are not often as simple as pick k elements. Maybe I have some budget constraints and every element has a different cost. So maybe my sensors in different locations are different costs to place. Maybe for some I have to climb on a tree and for some I can just place it somewhere. For some I have to fly on an airplane and drop it or something. So they could have different costs. And I have just a budget of how much time or how much money I want to spend. Does the greedy algorithm still work? So, as I showed you, it's not going to work directly like that. You have to make a small modification. Modification is not super large, but it has, here's what you have to do. So, two types of greedy algorithms and pick the best solution. The first one is the one that we saw. Pick essentially elements until your budget is exceeded and then it's gone. The second one also picks greedily, but it sort of looks at the best bang for the buck. So it divides the marginal gain by the actual cost of that element. So now something that's expensive, actually you have to gain a lot from it before you pick it. So that's how you pick the elements, and then you, like with this kind of scoring function, you run the greedy algorithm. Then you have two solutions, and you pick the better one of these solutions. So again, it's just a variant of a greedy algorithm, and it turns out actually this gives you at least half as good as the other. And you can do somewhat better with somewhat more complex algorithms that also cost more computationally more. So I just showed you the simplest version here. But it turns out, like often what you can do is some simplifications, some modifications to a greedy algorithm, and it still actually works. Of course, you have to show that, but this is one example. But then again, there may be other constraints that we have. So here's another set of constraints that we may consider. Here's, again, like examples from sensor placement because they are so easy to illustrate. Now I have cameras. Now I'm not only activating different cameras or placing them, actually every camera can also point in many different directions. So now what I have to choose, not only a set of cameras, but also where do they actually look. And of course now I cannot say I want camera, choose one A and one B, well this is like two different directions for the same camera. That's not going to be feasible, how am I going to do it? So I have actually other constraints, not only on the cameras or their cost or something, I have actually a constraint on I cannot pick every possible subset. I cannot pick certain items that are, certain items sort of rule each other out. So this is essentially the thing, is that for every camera I can only pick one direction. So how am I going to model this now? My greedy algorithm so far does not take this into account. So we model this. So essentially for every camera we make a box or a bucket or a group. And in this, from each group I'm only allowed to pick one item. Or I could also say I'm only allowed to pick two items from each group or four, but for simplicity, let's say. So we have these different groups, we have a partition of our element, and from every group we are allowed to pick only a certain number of items. For example, one. So, okay, so now we have formalized our constraints, and let's call all of these sets that satisfy this, basically at most one from each group. These are the feasible sets. And in fact, if you think a little bit, we could actually modify our greedy algorithm to work with this. I mean, in the end, we are just picking elements greedily. So we pick the first one, is unconstrained. Then we remove everything that the first one rules out, and we run the greedy algorithm, like the next greedy step. So we run greedy, but we never pick anything that's not allowed, essentially. Until we cannot pick anything else, we have picked one for each camera, for example. So that's pretty much the same algorithm with a slight difference that we only pick elements that are actually still allowed. And you could actually view our cardinality K constraint also in this framework. You could write it the same way where you said everything is feasible that has at most cardinality K. So we could do the greedy algorithm that way as well. So the question is, do we lose anything? Does this actually work still? Or could I somehow choose my cost function in my sets, my groups in some arbitrary bad way that to fool the algorithm that this is not going to give me anything useful at all. So it turns out actually now I'll pick like one for each camera and then rule out everything else from this camera. So it turns out actually the submodular functions are pretty friendly in that way that it's not possible to pick arbitrarily bad groups or so that I'll always get at least 50% of the optimal solution. So compared to 63% is not exactly the same, but it's also not too bad either. So this was actually pretty easy. No, this was like just run greedy again and like take care of the constraints. The question here is actually, does this always work? Can I take any possible set of constraints and I just like run greedy and I stop and I cannot do anymore? Like sort of like don't never pick anything that makes it infeasible. So this would unfortunately be too good to be true, so it's not true, but there's still a large set of, like, family of constraints that actually work like this. And these are called matroid constraints. So what are matroid constraints? When does this kind of thing actually give you at least this half approximation? So let's look, what is a matroid? So a matroid is, you can view it as a type of constraint or a family of sets that are called feasible, In the matroid world, they are called independent, because you can also view it as a generalization of linear independence. So they are called independent. Independent means feasible in this case. So a set is independent if blah. So let's look at a few examples of matroids, and then I'll show you what actually sort of they share and what characterizes what is a matroid. So the first one is all the sets that have cardinality at most k. So we saw this already. And we saw really algorithm works for this one. This is called the uniform matroid. Then there's the following matroid that my elements are partitioned into different groups or boxes, and we can pick at most one from each box, or we can pick at most two from each box, also works. Let's say one. So this is in fact the same as our camera. So this is called a partition matroid. And there's another one here, which is pretty illustrative, is the following, that I take a graph, and now all the elements are edges in this graph. And I'm not allowed to pick any set of edges that contains a cycle. So I'm allowed to pick all sorts of trees or forests in this graph, but no cycles. And this is called a graphic matroid for obvious reasons. So what do they have in common? What are the defining properties of a matroid? The first one is called down monotone. That means if a set is feasible, any subset of the set is also feasible. So let's say I have a set of k points. Any subset of this also has at most k points, trivially. If I have a set that has at most one in each box, if I remove some elements, they're also going to have at most one in each box. If I have something that doesn't have a cycle, if I remove some elements, it's not going to have a cycle. So this holds, and the empty set also is included in my constraints. The second one is a bit hairier, and this is called the exchange property. So essentially what it means is that you can take two feasible sets and you can always swap two elements in them. Here it's phrased slightly differently, but it's going to mean the same thing in the end. So exchange property means the following. Now we take two sets that are feasible. One is smaller than the other. So U is smaller than S, then U is the green part and S is the red part. And now it's always possible to pick at least one item from the larger set and add it to my smaller set. Smaller set is still feasible. So I can always find some element, not every, but some element in my red set that I can add to the green set, and that augmented set is still going to be feasible or allowed. So with the cardinality, it's pretty clear. The green one has to be smaller than k, so I can add any element, actually. For the partition matroid, I have to add something that I have, some box that I haven't filled yet, essentially. And for the cycles, you can also show it, but it's a bit longer to show that. So there's always some element I can add. You can verify this. What this also implies, actually, is that all the maximal feasible element sets, sort of the, all the sets where I cannot add any other element to keep them feasible, they all have the same size. So left-hand, in the uniform matroid, trivially, they all have size k. In the boxes, they all have number of boxes. And in the graphic matroids, they're all going to be spanning trees, the maximal feasible sets. So anything that satisfies these two, actually the top two things, the third one follows from the top things. These top two things, that's going to be a matroid. If your constraint satisfies these two things, then you can actually run the greedy algorithm. And then you get actually the same theorem. And greedy algorithm in the same way, I add anything that's still feasible. So the next question is more a question of a theoretician's question. And the next question is this the best possible? So if I'm a sort of like, I want to get the best possible algorithm or approximation factor. And obviously this 50% is pretty good. The question is, could I do better? Could I get 60, 70, 80? Probably I couldn't get 80. I told you, you cannot get better than 1 minus 1 over E for the cardinality. So, in fact, this is not the best possible you can get. So there's actually a way to get a better approximation that is though a bit more computationally intense than this one. But let me just show you the idea, because the idea is pretty interesting and it sort of relates to some of the other things we're going to do later. So here's the idea. The idea is that you actually do a relaxation of the problem. So you solve your discrete problem as a continuous problem. So you probably all have heard about like LP relaxation. It's kind of like that, but actually here we're going to have a non-linear relaxation. So here's the idea. Again, we have our set function. Our set function is a function on binary vectors. That means it's really a function that's defined on the corners of some hypercube, and that's it. So it's pretty discrete, some points living in the space, and what we want to do is we want to find some function that interpolates these points. We want to optimize that other interpolation, and then from that other thing, from that point that we get, go back to a discrete solution. So this is our relaxation. So we'll find some function that interpolates these points. Now, of course, if we want to do maximization, ideally we find a concave function that interpolates these points and from which we can read out the solution. It turns out a concave interpolation, the kind we want here, is actually hard to compute. So we'll have to do with something that looks like this one, like the saddle point thing over there. It turns out it's actually good enough. So the algorithm then is as follows. We take the thing on the right-hand side, our interpolation, we maximize as well as we can. And then we get some point. This point most likely is not going to be a 0-1 vector, it's going to be something in between. We have to cleverly bound that. So the algorithm essentially, it uses, you see this function is actually like sort of a saddle. It has some concave and some convex directions. So it uses essentially the concave directions to do the continuous maximization, is going to use the convex directions to round. That's how the algorithm works. And the algorithm itself is actually pretty closely related to the Frankwolf algorithm that we're going to see in lecture 2. So I'm not going to show it here. Yes?
I didn't understand how you did the mapping from elements
to the discrete set?
Yes, from the discrete set to the...
To this one? Okay, so essentially the idea is the following. That say you have your set. This is your ground set, A, B, C, D, E maybe, and you take a subset of these elements as a binary vector. By taking the indicator vector at one coordinate for each element, then you have 1, 1, 1, 0, 0. So you can represent each set as a binary vector. If you have n elements, this is going to live in R to the n, or 0, 1 to the n. So we get a function that is sort of like for every binary vector of n elements, we get a function value. So this is essentially what I drew here. So we have on two elements, we have 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 1, 1, 0, etc. So we get 4 points. This is for two elements, because otherwise it's hard to draw. So this is what we do here. And now we take this thing, and we have a function that's only in the binary vector. So this is these points, and now we interpolate these points. So this gives us a function that actually truly lives in R to the n and not on 0, 1 to the n. And how we actually get this function, I haven't told you yet. So I just said, we take some function, this is what it looks like in this particular example. So let's see how we could actually. So here's the idea. So what we want is that if we feed this continuous function a binary vector, it should spit out the same value as our submodular function. So this binary vector is an indicator vector. It should return exactly the same value as f of s, if this is s. Now we have a vector, like a continuous vector x, how could we have a function evaluation on this thing? So let's for a moment assume that x lives between 0 and 1, because that's good enough for these purposes. So the idea is but essentially the following, that let us define a probability distribution that's parameterized by my vector. A probability distribution over sets. And then my extension here is going to be the expectation over f of s, given that s is drawn from the distribution that's defined by x. So if x is binary, it's going to be just one set, all the mass on one set, otherwise it's something in between. So the simple distribution that we're going to use here is a product distribution that since x has entries between 0 and 1, the ith item is going to be sampled with probability xi. Interpret each of the entries as a probability. So now we sample, say p of 1 is in this case 0.5, p of 2 is 0.1, is 1, so we definitely sample the element and so on and so forth. So we can sample a set. And we can now, that's going to give us a distribution over sets, it's a product distribution. We can now take the expectation over this. And this is exactly what this function is. You also see if x is binary, you're going to get probability 1 for some items, probability 0 for the others, so you always get the same set. So you get f of s for that particular s. So this is our interpolation. It looks like the saddle point function, it turns out. You can actually maximize it. This thing is not super easy to compute because it has exponentially many terms, so the way to evaluate it is by sampling. And it turns out to be good enough, but it's not as cheap as running a greedy algorithm. Okay, so we saw now that, but essentially, one more thing about this, essentially this is called the continuous greedy algorithm. Essentially this sort of like hill climbing algorithm that this thing does, even in the continuous case, all of this is kind of still a greedy algorithm. So we saw all flavors of greedy algorithms, essentially. So we saw it actually works greedy. Kind of the interesting thing is it's NP-hard, the problem, but greedy kind of works for a large number of constraints in some way or the other. And it's pretty simple. The only thing is, like, if I actually have a large number of items, even a greedy algorithm is not super cheap. If you think about it, like, the first best item you have to, in the worst case, scan through all your elements. The second one, you have to scan through all your elements to find it. Then the third best one, you again have to scan through all your elements. And if n and k are large, this is going to cost you a lot of time, even though it's pretty simple. There's some, like, things you can do to speed it up, but in any case, it's still if you have a large number of elements. So is there anything we can do to speed it up? Even a simple greedy algorithm can become slow. And of course, there's a number of ideas how you can make it faster. We're going to look at two of them. One is that how you can actually do it a faster sequential, and then we look at one version how you can actually make it parallel or distributed. And the last question is, well, so far we only talked about monotone increasing functions. What if my function is not monotone increasing? What do I do? So first of all, let's look at how we could make the greedy algorithm faster. And here's a simple idea how you can make it faster, and it turns out it works. So I said, well, the bottleneck is that in every time you have to scan through your entire set of elements, that's slow. So let's get rid of that. And the following way is to get rid of that. Instead of looking at all possible elements in every augmentation step, we sample a small subset. And we only look at that subset and find the best point in that subset. And then we resample. So algorithm is as follows, that in every step, we run k steps. Let's say we select k elements. We pick only a small set t. T is, of course, not too small, so it's order of n over k times log something. And we find the best item in that. And then we add it to our set, and then we continue. We pick another set, we find the best augmenting item, and so on and so forth, and then we've done it k times. So overall, since each item is only size roughly n over k, we are roughly linear time. Times some constants that ensure that we get this actually a good solution with high probability. So here's how this works. And actually, so I didn't actually put the, okay, so what you may also wonder is, can I actually guarantee anything about this? So I didn't put it here, but what it essentially you can guarantee is that you don't lose too much. You get 1 minus 1 over e, which depends on this epsilon over here with sufficient probability. So you actually don't lose too much by doing this stochastic thing. And if you think about it, actually, moreover, in many data sets, many problems, things are somewhat redundant, so you can actually also assume that this is actually not going to be too bad. Also, you're going to hit every point, at least most points, high probability. Okay, so how does this actually work in practice? Here's some plot that I took from the paper that presents this. Here is the speed, so to the left is better. So this actually running time, to the left is better. On the y-axis we have quality of solution. So higher is better, so we want to reach the upper left corner. So we don't care what are all these thousands of different points, but this is, it's a faster version of the greedy algorithm, so this is exact. This is exactly the same one that my greedy algorithm would return me. So quality-wise is pretty good, but running time-wise it's a bit to the right-hand side because that one still takes time. So if I run my stochastic version with different epsilons, I see it actually gains me almost as good as the greedy algorithm, but much faster. So it's actually, you can't speed up the greedy algorithm this way. But then I may get more and more and more data, or maybe my data is actually somehow distributed, maybe even that stochastic greedy algorithm is no longer good enough. So the next question is it possible to make this greedy algorithm parallel or distributed? And this may seem like a very natural idea, but if you think about the greedy algorithm per se, it's actually pretty sequential. Like the second element already heavily depends on what I choose as the first element, and the ith element heavily depends on what I chose before the ith element. So every time I sort of find the best augmenting point, and if I don't know what I chose beforehand, maybe I'll just pick the same thing twice, or something that's pretty much redundant. So how am I going to sort of ensure that this is not going to happen? This is essentially the problem if I want to parallelize the greedy algorithm. So how are we going to do this? Here's an idea. Let's pick m different machines and let's distribute our points across these machines. And then now each machine has a smaller data set. Let's run greedy on these smaller data sets. So we pick k elements on each machine. If we want to pick k, and then we union them. So we have like mk elements, and then we run greedy again. Sounds like a reasonable idea. Hopefully we're not going to miss anything in each machine. We sort of pick the key best ones. We overpick a little bit, so we have MK, and then we merge them. So it doesn't seem unreasonable to be doing that. So the question is, does it work? Can I lose any information from this? So in fact, if you now look at it, there's different ways to look at it. You can look at it from a theoretical perspective. And in fact, you can show that the approximation factor is no longer 1 minus 1 over e, but if I have m machines, it shrinks as 1 over m. Sort of, I could miss a 1 over m fraction of the good points, essentially. That doesn't sound so good, because maybe I want a lot of machines, or root k also doesn't sound so great. Like, 1 point would already be a k approximation, so root k doesn't sound all that great. But then, nevertheless, if you run this algorithm in practice, well, here's what happens. Here's again a huge number of lines. What essentially this shows is that even if I take a lot of machines, actually this thing works pretty well. Surprisingly so. So even though my it should be shrinking with the number of machines, in reality it seems to be doing fine. Actually, this is what you often see, is sort of, you have your theoretical worst case guarantee, and then you run it and you see it actually works, and then you wonder why. Like, can you explain why? So let me give you two explanations. The first one is that often your data set is actually not worst case. So often you actually do have redundancy in your data set. Say you do this summarization thing, maybe you have things that are actually redundant, but they sort of reside on different machines, so you're going to pick at least one of them. So often you have sort of this redundancy that helps you. You have sort of like independent samples from the same distribution in each machine. That shouldn't be too bad, actually. The second thing is that actually, if you slightly modify the algorithm and the proof, you can actually prove something much better. So randomization helps here. So here's the slight modification of this algorithm, which maybe we have done anyways. Yes?
Where is the loss coming from? From the information.
Yeah, so the thing is, the like worst case thing you show by something that's not an IID thing, where you do not distribute points IID, that it's not data points that come from the same distribution, and you take subsamples and you put them into different machines, but it's some other function that's not IID data points, and they're very carefully put onto different machines that essentially you fool the algorithm. So to show that you actually achieve this like bad 1 over m thing, it's not an IID random selection thing. It's a very constructed example. So I have it somewhere. I don't think I can construct it off the top of my head, but it's actually a fairly simple example, but it relies on the fact that you have a very special function and you distribute your points very carefully across different machines.
So it also matches the function we're trying to obtain.
Pardon?
It also matches the function we're trying to
It is susceptible to the function you're using. So what do you mean by susceptible to randomization?
We have a function which requires the data to have special properties in order to be evaluated correctly, like some global properties.
Oh, I see. No, no. The function is deterministic, and it's like just a deterministic function of the data that we assume here. So it's all deterministic at that point. So the function, you have an instance of the problem, which is like some sample, some data, or some other thing. This is all deterministic. There's no randomness, and the function doesn't rely on anything at all. So it's just the function that we can evaluate at this point. Of course, there's like good and bad functions in the sense that there's some functions that are better behaved than others, as always in optimization. But it doesn't rely on anything else. So here, actually, the randomization comes in that we randomly distribute data points across the different machines. So actually, that idea is that in the previous sort of when you show the worst case example, it's very much drafted that the distribution of the data points across the machines is very much aligned with it, like non-aligned with the function. So they depend on each other. If you do it randomly, most likely you're not going to have this, and most other assignments are going to be fine. So you randomly distribute your points, and now the other slight modification is that instead of picking k out of the ones that you pick the best out of the k machine solutions and your joint solutions. So now what you can show is the following, that say every machine runs an alpha approximation algorithm, so let's say for simplicity every machine gets a 1 minus 1 over e approximation. In level 2 you do a beta approximation, beta could also be the greedy algorithm, so you get also 1 minus 1 over e, then overall what you get is alpha beta over alpha plus beta. If I make this both the greedy algorithm, then it's like 1 minus 1 over e over 2. So I lose a factor of 2 versus a factor of m, which is much, much better. So in expectation, actually, this thing works better. Okay. So we saw actually, yes, no more question?
How do you distribute the second pieces and you give some pieces in?
Yes. So this is like different items. Yeah, and every machine assumingly can evaluate the function on these items. This assumes you can do this actually. Like, alright. So we saw now many different versions of greedy algorithms. We saw it works for many different constraints. You can also distribute it. So far, however, we only assume that the function is actually monotone increasing. What I didn't say at all is what happens if my function is no longer monotone increasing. So you could, for example, have the setting that I don't have my coverage function, I have, for example, a graph function. Or I have something that's a coverage function minus a cost. Maybe you actually want to trade off your gain from coverage with a cost that you get by paying for every sensor, and that's going to be no longer monotone increasing, because at some point you will get no longer gain from your sensors and you only pay for the additional ones, you're going to go down again. So we have this problem of non-monotone functions. What happens in this case? We'll assume for simplicity they are non-negative. So my voice now tells me I should take a break, so we'll do this after the break. I think there's a short coffee break now.
Maybe you can directly ask Steffi in person more than in that way. You just have to reply again.
Oh, I can also reply.
Yeah,
it's okay. I'll have some water.
There is a couple of questions.
Mm-hmm. This last case is not submodular.
Which this one? No, it's still submodular. Yeah. So both these are still. We proved that the graph cut function is a submodular function. It's just not. So it can be submodular. That's sort of a second property. Any other questions?
Okay, let's again. One logistical issue, whoever has some restriction like is vegetarian or gluten-free should come now here because we are gonna give a small card for tonight for the dinner, okay?
Something like 60 inside.
Mark.